So very good afternoon. Today we'll be having the second part of the Osh's reconstructive surgery. So from this class we would like you to classify the materials in the reconstructive surgery, explain the role of different techniques in reconstructive surgery, apply the knowledge during the treatment plan using the advanced surgical procedures, and outline the effectiveness of Osh's reconstructive surgeries. The contents of this class would include most on non-graft associated reconstructive procedures, the root biomodification, prevention of epithelial migration, and biologic and biomimicry mediators. The first class we saw on graft-associated reconstructive procedures. So starting with root conditioning procedures, this strategy focuses on the treatment with citric acid or tetracycline to demineralize the root surface. The conditioned root surface reportedly enhances the formation of new connective tissue attachment. So why root surface biomodification may improve the periodontal regeneration? It is found that biocompatibility of root surface is essential in regenerative procedures. The root surface represents one of the wounded margins, and it provides an appropriate surface. It should provide an appropriate surface for cell attachment, colonization, and proliferation. It promotes linking of the biomolecules, example the extracellular matrix proteins, to the exposed collagen in the root surface. So various chemical agents have been used for root biomodification. So they have been listed out below. We will see the few chemical agents in detail. So starting with the citric acid, which is used at pH 1. Citric acid at pH 1 for 2 to 3 minutes resulted in new connective tissue attachment as well as cementogenesis. After 1 to 2-3 days, it was found that a fibrin linkage was present between the periodontal ligament and the root surface. After 21 days, the fibrin network appeared to be well attached to the root surface. This fibrin linkage has been shown to impede the apical migration of the epithelium, results in a rapid ingress of the cells, which putatively will develop the new connective tissue attachment. The second one is the tetracycline. Tetracycline burnished for around 3 minutes, similar to the citric acid, on the root surface without inducing any pulpal or epithelial injuries have been shown to promote regeneration. This has been shown to bind to the dentin, with maximum binding occurring when the tetracycline is applied 50 mg or greater. Advantages: it is a kind of a local antimicrobial drug delivery which is sufficient for up to 14 days. It binds to the fibronectin, a cell adhesion protein that mediates the cell attachment and migration of the mesenchymal cells. The presence of the fibronectin permits increased cell adhesion and colonization. Conversely, tetracycline reverses the binding of laminin and epithelial cell attachment protein. Tetracycline treatment preferentially permits the colonization and the migration of the fibroblasts over the epithelial cells. The third one is your fibronectin, which is a high glycoprotein found on the surface of cells in plasma extracellular matrix and in basement membrane. So how is this used to promote gingival or epithelial regeneration? So it plays an important role in the promoting the attachment of cell to one another and to the extracellular matrix and the collagen, increases the fibroblast attachment. It is a chemoattractant for the fibroblasts and the periodontal ligament cells, possesses therapeutic utility in promoting connective tissue attachment, biologic mediator that enhances the tissue response in early phases of wound healing, prevents separation of flaps and favors hemostasis and regeneration. Uses of fibronectin as a supplement to demineralization. It stimulates the coronal growth of cells from the periodontal ligament responsible for new attachment. It favors the growth and attachment of fibroblasts and over the cemental surface. It speeds the linkage process by chemoattractive nature for the fibroblasts. It also stabilizes the clot between the exposed root surface and the new fibers. The fifth one, that is your EDTA, it is a chelating agent. It forms by functioning a calcium chelate solution with the calcium ions. It softens the root surface, removes the smear layer, effects a partial demineralization to a depth of 20 to 30 minutes for 5 minutes. So there are certain limitations when you are going to use such chemical substances. This may give rise to secondary endodontic involvement via the dental antibules. Depth of action cannot be controlled. Increased size of dentinal tubules are there. More penetration of microorganisms may cause root caries. Chemicals may unfavorably alter the morphology of the collagen. So what are the expected outcome from out of all this which we want? We want a general new attachment with good regeneration is the ideal outcome of the therapy. There are certain complications which may be seen with them. One, this we have already checked out in the last class, that is, it could be healing with a long junctional epithelium, ankylosis and result root resorption, recurrence of pocket can occur, or it could be a combination of above. But besides all this, benefits, if they outweigh risk, then we are going to go in for the procedure. Next, coming on to the prevention of the epithelial migration by means of guided tissue regeneration. So this process involves applying the surgical wound site. So this is the surgical wound site. You're going to apply an occlusive barrier membrane that will prevent the growth of the epithelial and the connective tissue growth in this area. So this membrane blocks the unwanted tissue, allowing the ligament fibers and bone to grow. Once strong ligament fibers attach to the root, then the membrane dissolves or it is removed. So this enables the stem cells from the periodontal ligament and perivascular tissues to repopulate the area, the wounded area here, and differentiate into a new periodontal supporting attaching apparatus. So if this is not allowed, then cells from the epithelium will go into this place. Because of this barrier, the cells from the periodontal ligament go into this space and form the correct regenerative therapy. Occlusive barriers may also be used either in alone or in combination with a bone graft or an alloplastic material. So why is GTR needed? It is a method for prevention of the epithelial migration along the cemental wall of the pocket, thereby maintaining a space for the clot stabilization. GTR consists of placing a barrier of different types to cover the bone and the periodontal ligament, thus separating them from the gingival epithelium and the connective tissue. So ideal membrane for GTR procedures should be absorbable, biocompatible, cell occlusive, space maintenance should be provided, tissue integration should be there, it should be clinically manageable. The indications for guided regeneration are class 2 furcation defects, 2 or 3 wall vertical defects, recession and alveolar ridge preservation cases. So based on all ideal features, you do have certain classification for GTR membrane given by Gottlob. So first generation, it was a non-resorbable membrane, so which you have to take out after a period of 5 weeks. The second generation are a resorbable set of membrane which resorbs by itself. The third generation, resorbable membrane with growth factors. So this growth factors, we will be reading about this in the third kind of non-graft associated procedure, that is your biologic mediators. So coming on to the membranes for guided tissue regeneration, they are of two types, non-resorbable and resorbable. EPTFE, that is extended polytetrafluoroethylene membranes which are present, millipore and nucleopore filters, silicone barriers are present as non-resorbable membranes. Resorbable membranes include the polylactide, polyglycolic acid or vicryl mesh, which are synthetics. If you want a natural one, we do have the collagen membrane for guided tissue regeneration. The most common one which we plan is for the this one, interproximal, so that you can place in the interproximal defects very beautifully. Resorbable membranes which are marketed in US is the OsteoQuest, which is a combination of the polyglycolic acid, polylactic acid and trimethylene carbonate that resorbs 6 to 14 months. BioGuide, a bilayer porcine-derived collagen. Atrisorb, a polylactide acid gel. Biomen, a bovine Achilles tendon collagen that resorbs in 4 to 18 weeks. So these are the resorbable membranes which are available. Now coming on to the techniques for the non-resorbable membrane, how do you go? You go in for a raising of a mucoperiosteal flap with vertical incision, extending for a minimum of 2 teeth anteriorly and 1 tooth distally being distal to the tooth being treated. You're going to debride the osseous defects and thoroughly plane the roots. Then trim the membrane according to that area with sharp scissors approximate to the size of area being treated. And then place the membrane and suture it tightly around the tooth with a sling suture. And then put back the flap again. Put back the flap again to the original position or to a slightly coronal position using independent sutures intermittently and apply the pack. It can be removed out with a tug after 5 weeks from the procedure. So So here you can see a defect which is present. We have placed a Resorb membrane. So the defect after it has been opened, so you can see that the bone has been formed here. So this is the correct type of regeneration, bone loss, and after the re-entry, surgical re-entry, when it was done, the bone formation is present. So this is a GTR membrane which we have in the department. So when is a patient needed or advised for GTR? If the patient is periodontally stable, when his full mouth bleeding score is less than 5%, then go in for checking for his plaque score. If it's less than 10%, then they consider the patient for GTR. If no, such patients are not advised for GTR procedures. Here, generally, they are purified biologic or synthetic biomimicry agents. So this could be either the purified biologic form is the enamel matrix derivative, and the synthetic biomimicry agents are your platelet-derived growth factors and your bone morphogenic proteins. So platelet-derived growth factors are of two types, platelet-rich plasma and platelet-rich fibrin. So coming on to platelet-rich plasma, this is obtained by sequestering and concentrating the platelets by gradient density centrifugation. Concentrated platelet-rich plasma is prepared from the patient's own blood and is activated by the addition of thrombin and calcium. The structure consists of a three-dimensional biocompatible fibrin scaffold with limited volume of plasma enriched in platelets. Platelet concentrate, which contains platelets and growth factors in the form of fibrin membranes. This is prepared from the patient's own blood, free of any anticoagulant or other biochemical combinations. So you have these steps how to proceed with the procuring of the PRF membrane. The PRF clot forms a strong natural fibrin matrix which concentrates almost all the platelets growth factors of the blood harvest, shows a complex architecture as a healing matrix with unique mechanical properties which makes it distinct from other platelet concentrates. So you can also do a combination technique where you can use a graft and GTR membrane. So here you can see a bone defect which is present. So a graft has been applied and over that a GTR membrane has been applied. Defect is closed. So you can see how much is the bone gain which has occurred after the treatment. Last one is your enamel matrix protein. It mainly consists of amelogenins which are secreted by the Hertwig's epithelial root sheath during the tooth development, and this induces the acellular cementum formation. FDA has approved EMP marketing under the name Emtogay. 90% of the protein in this mixture is amelogenin, with the rest primarily prolin-rich non-amelogenins, tuftalins, tuft proteins, serum proteins, ameloblastin and amelin. So to conclude, reconstructive periodontal surgical procedures provide the most dramatic improvement in the treatment of intraboronial defects of all currently available modalities. The amount of the defect that is filled by the bone, presumably periodontal ligament and cementum, varies, but it is optimal is around 70-75% fill. Another critical component of wound healing process may be the timing of cellular invasion. Thank you.